Sir, and thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Good morning, Christian.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, sad day today. I'll start with the former Secretary Judy Taguiwalo. Let's start with this very amazing atmosphere that we have now, in the sense that the passing of Gina Lopez has, of course, solicited a lot of good words, a lot of condolences across the spectrum. You have people from government, you have people from the left, the indigenous peoples, the women's groups. I'll start with Secretary Judy Taguiwalo. Why is this? How was this made possible? In the sense that, for example, people from the left like you were also very, very close to the former Environment Secretary.
Okay, I'll start. When I was a student a long time ago, we picketed a very grandiose celebration of the Lopezes, a silver wedding anniversary which had a champagne fountain. And then you can imagine Gina Lopez veering away from this kind of life to work with the people. So when I had the chance to work with her in the cabinet, I really found her a maverick, no, a Lopez who was really passionate and concerned about the environment and really persistent and determined to protect the mountains, to protect our water sources, to protect our indigenous peoples. And we had debates within the cabinet regarding that, but she stood her ground.
How was it actually working with then Environment Secretary Gina Lopez inside the cabinet of President Duterte? Because she also had other cabinet officials who did not see eye to eye with her. How did the debates go?
I think, in the first place, it was we start at 4 o'clock and then it goes on until late evening. Gina had their own food because, you know, she was into a different diet. And sometimes she would share it with us. So there was a sisterhood among the women secretaries at that time. I think the most memorable incident was when she presented the programs of the DNR to the cabinet. It was a very well-prepared video presentation. She was very passionate, she was very articulate, and she showed the effects, the devastation that mining firms have done to our mountains and to our communities. At the same time, she provided clear alternatives that we can develop our countryside, our rural areas without destroying the environment. And for that, you know, she was praised by the president at the time.
And how did the members of the economic team respond to that presentation,
open,
for example?
That's not a secret. I think the economic team, Secretary Dominguez appeared during the commission on appointment. I think it's very unusual for another secretary to attend the confirmation of another secretary and to present a position which is not favorable to the secretary being confirmed. So that differences have not been limited to the cabinet meetings. It came out. So Secretary Gina is firm about people first before business, people before profit. Well, Secretary Dominguez said, no, you cannot be a crusader. You are a secretary. You have to stand, you know, look at both sides. And I think that's why people love Secretary Gina. For the first time, there was a Secretary of the Environment who was clearly with the people, who was clearly strong enough to take a stand against big mining and corporate interests.
Somehow you felt that you had an ally in the cabinet because at that time you and two other nominees by the progressive movement became part of the cabinet of President Duterte.
Can you repeat that?
Yeah, that somehow you felt that you had a real ally inside the cabinet because at that time, I remember, you were still in the cabinet with two other progressives. You were part of the so-called progressive bloc inside the cabinet.
Okay. She was a dynamo by herself. I think her strength was she was a Lopez, you know, and she was a Lopez. She had also the hands-on experience on the ground. She was not just in the offices but she was very much present in the field. So when she talks about what is happening to our people, what is happening to the indigenous communities, it came from a position of personal knowledge, and I think that gave her a leverage not present in other secretaries.
Okay, now JB, you're part of the Alianza Tigal Mina.
Yes.
Now the stint of Gina Lopez at the Department of Environment and Natural Resources was fairly short. I think only around 10 months.
Yes.
And then her appointment or nomination was rejected by the powerful Commission on Appointments. Now let's talk about the impact made by Gina Lopez during that short stint at the DNR.
I think what we got with that was a taste of how a very dedicated, committed, and passionate leader and a woman leader can actually make differences. You know, I would describe that 10 months whenever we have our assemblies of the environmental movement. We still treat that 10 months as along a realm of a dream. You know, nobody could imagine that, you know, we could actually make things work inside the department as long as there is a dedicated, committed, and passionate leader at the top. And, you know, those changes that she instituted are still in force. So, for example, the only audit of mines happened during her time, which was supposed to be a regulatory function. It should have been a regular function when you monitor mines. The closure and suspension orders, to our memory, she was the only DNR secretary that actually made that decision. And, you know, technically, those closure orders and suspension orders, they're still alive and they are implementable. And I think the powerful message that was sent during her stint was, you know, it's not business as usual. You know, there, and I think Gina Lopez symbolized concretely that promise of real change that the Duterte administration promised during the campaign. Unfortunately, that promise of change was cut short. And you know, her non-confirmation, or well, let's be honest about it, her rejection of the Commission on Appointments doesn't mean she's not fit to be DNR secretary. It only means that the more powerful interests and agenda of corporations who are in control of many of our politicians got the leverage on that day. And, you know, it was the people who got the losing end of that deal when Gina Lopez was rejected.
How about the mining companies now? Are they generally behaving better after the changes instituted by Gina Lopez at the DNR?
Without a doubt. You know, some of the changes that Ma'am Gina did are still happening right now. You know, the mine audit that I mentioned earlier. I know that the second round of audit procedures will happen within the year. The budget for that has been approved. You know, and Ma'am Gina, being consistent with the Duterte administration's trust, one of her pet initiatives was increasing transparency and accountability within the mining industry. And she issued one specific administrative order that she made a requirement for all mining companies to participate in an EITI initiative, which requires mining companies to submit and disclose their financial reports, transactions, and payments. That requirement is still in force, and I know mining companies are complying with that. But you know, I think the other legacy is the mining industry now understand that they cannot do things as they were used to. You know, the extractive industry, much like any other industry, feels they're entitled to be friends or to be given incentives by the government. But what Gina Lopez gave the DNR is, no, we're here to regulate you. You have to follow the law. And if you're not following the law, it's either you're bribing or corrupting government, or you're not following our laws. At the end of the day, it's the communities and the people, and in this case, the environment is at the raw end of the deal. And I guess that message has been sent powerfully to the industries.
Okay. Now, Secretary Judy, you and the former Secretary Gina Lopez are somehow on the same boat in the sense that both of your nominations were rejected by the Commission on Appointments. Now, during that time, first during the process that she went through at the CA, were you able to speak with her and somehow exchange notes when it comes to the issues that you were carrying and in dealing with the members of the CA?
Oh, definitely. We'd see each other. Her meeting with the CA would then, and mine would be starting, would meet each other in the corridor. But during this time, CABSEC Juni Vasco also organized a meeting with DNR, with DSWD to assist mine workers who were displaced because of the closures of the mines, which were not following the environmental rules. So actually, we're working together to ensure that the environment is protected and the workers are given jobs, but that also stopped after our rejection. So when Secretary Gina was rejected and she sang, I believe I can fly, and then my confirmation was about to start also, I have to also think about my song, but because I'm not as good a singer as Gina, I said, okay, my song is, do you hear the people sing, but I'm not going to sing it. But Gina's song is actually her. It is I Believe I Can Fly, and she did it. She flew, she soared, and we appreciated what she has done in the short time that she was secretary, and we're very happy to be a colleague of hers. Later on, we would meet, we had a lunch at her house, and she showed us around, you know. And so for when she got sick, we also communicated, and she said, you know, I'm fine, I love everybody, I'm fighting on. So it is with deep sadness that we learned about her death. But again, as we said, you know, sabi ko noon, I said, walang forever sa posisyon, but may forever sa paglilingkod. And I think Secretary Gina showed that. She served the people as Secretary of DNR and even outside DNR.
Now, we all remember that song that she sang, I Believe I Can Fly, after she was rejected by the CA. But afterward, during your interaction, Secretary Taguiwalo, with Gina Lopez, afterward, somehow did you also sense even a bit of disappointment coming from Gina Lopez with the way the proceedings at the CA went?
I think she knew she would not be confirmed because she stood her ground. There was no compromise for her in terms of what she believed as her principles. What did she say in one interview? You cannot just follow the rules. You cannot be rule-bound because rules change. But you have to hang on to your principles, you know. Regardless of the changes in the situation, the principles will see you through. And she showed that, no? And I think even if she was not confirmed, we've seen how she worked afterwards. She remained a champion of the environment, a champion of the indigenous peoples, and a champion of the country. And we salute her for that.
Now, JB, did your group also have a chance to work with Secretary Lopez after her nomination was rejected by the CA?
Oh, yeah. You know, after the hearing at the Senate, she treated most of us to a dinner somewhere in the seaside in Pasay City. And after dinner, around 8 o'clock, she said, okay, guys, let's meet in my office on Monday. And she asked us for several meetings, and the result of that was the I Love Foundation. You know, her reaction to that rejection was simply, you know, I don't need to be DNR secretary to do what I wanted to do. So immediately, she established the I Love Foundation, and it was the same all over. She went to the communities, one of the challenges that we faced whenever we are working with Gina Lopez is we are from NGOs, but she treats us like her staff. So she gives orders and instructions to everyone immediately. And she says, okay, you guys, I want a map of all the affected communities in 1 week. Two, I want to set up a fund for all of those community-based enterprises. You have to help me find the right ones, and we have to market them, and we have to really serve the poor people. So immediately after her rejection, I mean, that speaks of how the energy and the light and the positivity of Gina Lopez is all about. Okay, this is a new chapter in my life, but nothing's going to change my commitment. She wanted to serve. She set up I Love Foundation, and she made sure that she was working with the communities and making sure that her influence as a Lopez and her family and her clout would be put to good use in making sure that they serve. those that really need support and assistance.
So basically, two perspectives here. Number one, her efforts were not wasted. And perhaps the second one is that perhaps she was even more effective after she was rejected by the CA because she was back to what she had been actually doing for most of her life. JB.
Yeah, well, you know, working with her in the past 8 years, I think she was very good in delivering results, programs, and projects. And she did tell us several times, you know, she would make a lousy lawmaker. she was a good executive person. She makes good directives, she conceptualizes good programs, and then she's able to, you know, inspire and encourage everyone working with her to make that contribution. And I think that positivity is her lasting legacy. She did make change happen. She was an inspiration to many. And while that would be a losing, I mean, that's a significant loss for many of us, but, you know, that inspiration should serve as the seeds for us to continue what she has started.
Well, Secretary Judy Taguiwalo and Jaybee Garganera, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.